This Sunday is the first Sunday in our new series called Relief. And we're going to be spending 5 Sundays on this. And in this series, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be reading through the book of Colossians. Now, Colossians is a book that's going to be teaching us about what relief means in relationship to Christ and what relief means in relationship to the church. And I encourage you to come along with us on this journey. And as I began to think about relief and relief as kind of the title of the series, maybe you were doing the same thing as me. Maybe you started thinking, I think they're going to try to sell me something. Because I've seen marketing in this world already, and I know that there's a vast majority of marketing that seems to want to tell me that there's something that I need to be relieved from, and that they have the thing that is relief to me that they're offering me, and they want me to buy it. So maybe you were thinking, relief, they're trying to sell me something. And maybe this is a Sunday in which you've been invited in here. A friend of yours has said, hey, come on out. And you said, sure, I'll come, but I'm not buying. Not today. Okay. Fair enough. You know, maybe this is one of those places where I'm going to make the kind of, you're not quite ready for this offer yet sort of sales pitch. Maybe this is the kind of, let's talk about you first. See if you actually qualify for the offer sort of a sales pitch. So what kind of relief are we talking about? I'd love to start with a conversation with you and say, where are you in life? If you've come in here thinking to yourself, I'm not ready to buy, my first questions would be, who are you? Why did you come here? What brought you here this morning? What else is happening in your life? And as we begin to talk about who you are and what's happening in your life, then I begin to introduce, here's the ideas of relief that we're talking about from the book of Colossians. And it's important to know that the relief that the book of Colossians talks about is not an instant relief that solves all your problems. This isn't the magic pill relief. It's not one of those flash-in-the-pans marketing gimmicks that we've got going here. Instead, this is the relief that comes to somebody who's been in the desert a long time. If you've been in the desert a long time, no question that first drink of water is relief, but it's only part of the longer process of relief. As your body needs to heal from having been in the desert for a long period of time, you need a whole life healing. You need the whole package, if you will. No, I'm using too much sales language, am I not? I'm not trying to sell you something this morning. Let's be very clear about that. I'm not trying to sell you something this morning. I'm not trying to sell you on how much I want you to be connected to me. I'm not trying to sell you something about Prairie Alliance Church, and you know, you need to really be, this is the place, this is the magic. I'm not trying to sell you something. I'm trying to tell you about somebody. I'm trying to tell you about Jesus Christ. And my hope isn't that you would buy him. My hope is that you would meet him. That as I speak this morning, that even as you have already been participating or even just listening to our worship this morning, my hope is that already you are beginning to sense there. These people believe there's actually another presence in the room. And hopefully by the end of this service, or maybe come to all 5, and then maybe this is my guarantee, if you come to all 5 of the services and you don't feel relief, why don't you just give me a conversation? Why don't you get in contact with me, and let's go out for coffee. I'm buying. And if you've come to all 5 services, maybe you can miss 1 or 2, watch them online, but let's go out for coffee afterwards, and let's talk. Why do you think this series didn't feel like relief to you? I would enjoy that conversation very much. So would you turn with me now? Let's open the text of Colossians. I'm going to read from verses 1 to 14, and then I'm going to skip down and read verses 28 and 29. Give ear as I read this text. This is the Word of God. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of truth, the gospel that has come to you. just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we have heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. It is he who we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil and struggle with all the energy that he powerfully inspires within me. Thus far, God's word. Let me pray. Father God, we give you thanks, for you have spoken your word and written it down through your apostle Paul. And you have given this text to us and preserved it over the years, so that we might hear from you this morning through your word of truth. We ask now that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would illumine our minds, rekindle our hearts, and strengthen our wills. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. So Paul is writing to the Colossians. And what we know about Paul at this time, he includes this a little detail at the end of the letter, that he is in prison as he writes this letter. And we know from some of his other letters and from the book of Acts that Paul spent his time journeying around parts of Asia and parts of what we now call Europe. He was journeying around there, and he experienced a lot of hardship. He was beaten. He was stoned within an inch of his life. He received lashes and whippings. He was chased out of town many times. He was shipwrecked. He was bitten by a snake that was very deadly. And he was put into prison. And yet through all this, if you read his letter, there's no sense of bitterness. There's no sense of, oh, woe is me. As Paul writes this letter, he has a joy that is exuberant, that comes through in his words. Even when he chastises either these Colossians, these people that he's writing to, and he says, I think you guys can do better. Even when he says those kinds of words, there still is a reverberating hope through all of his work. How does he do it? How does this man, who seems to have had a life that, by any standard of success that we have, he has not met that life of success, how does he still have such joy and hope? Well, in the Colossians, in this letter, Paul talks about maturity. He says, I am struggling with everything that I powerfully have, that God has inspired me to do, to build up in you maturity to the fullness of God. And it's this maturity that Paul is expressing when he can, no matter what context he finds himself in, be a man who is rooted in Christ so that he has the joy and peace that Christ gives him, and so that he is finding in Christ all that he needs to be a full and flourishing human being, even though he's in prison. And it's this maturity that our series is going to be talking about. So over the 5 Sundays, we're going to be talking about maturity, and we're going to be trying to figure out what is Paul mean by maturity? Relief. We're going to be talking about maturity. I know, that may not have been the most kind of sexy catchphrase for marketing that's ever come out. You know, relief, we're going to talk about maturity. As soon as I think about maturity and what that means, I think maybe you do the same thing. I think about conversations I have with my wife, and we use the word adulting. This is the phrase that we often will say to one another. You know, today, I don't really feel like adulting. That means pajamas, usually some chocolate, maybe ice cream, You don't even care about the dishes. And we understand what this means. We give ourselves, okay, it's a non-adult day for her. It's a non-adult day for him. We like to do our non-adult days together. It's wonderful that way. But there's a sense in which adulting has lost its charm for us. And you can tell this in our society when you look at the media that we consume, the media that we look at, and you think, of course, of the classic Peter Pan. I don't want to ever grow up. And we think about other forms of media that teach us that, in fact, being responsible, being the adult, is boring. Think of all the TV shows that you have ever watched. These are not responsible, mature people. If they were, it would not be a very interesting sitcom. We need them to be immature people. That's entertainment. But subtly undercutting that, undercutting our lives, is the idea that maturity is boring. Maturity is not something you want. So what I need to do first here is I need to reframe what we think maturity is. Maturity, the way that Paul's using it here, is maturity like a plant or like a tree. When you think of a mature tree, it delivers fruit on a level that an immature tree can never match. When you think of maturity of a plant, you planted this plant as a seed, you celebrate the sprouts, this is a wonderful but immature plant. But when it becomes to a mature plant and it flowers and it blooms and it's glorious and beautiful, we celebrate its maturity. This is a very good thing. It's very exciting. We need to have that kind of maturity in our minds as we read this text, as we go through this series. God is drawing us towards maturity. It's the maturity, the fullness, the flourishing of life where we produce great fruit. This is what God is calling us to. And so Colossians is going to pull out for us the threads of maturity. And along the way, we're going to pay attention to five aspects of maturity. I'm going to list them off now, and I'm going to talk about them briefly here. But don't worry about trying to memorize each of the five. Like I say, we're going to be talking about this throughout the series. And on any given Sunday, we'll be talking about maybe two or three of these five elements or five characteristics of maturity. As I work through them now, maybe pay attention to which one of these five catches your attention. Hey, there's one that I might actually be a little bit more immature on. As I work through the rest of the sermon this morning, pay attention. Which of these five captures your attention and your imagination? The first one is depth. The maturity that Colossians speaks of is a maturity of depth. Without depth, we have shallowness. Shallowness may be broad, but it will be an immature quality to it. The depth that Colossians speaks of, it uses the line in the text that we read, the fullness, the knowledge and understanding to the fullness of God. Like, it's an incredible depth that Colossians is calling us to. Maturity that Colossians wants us to shoot for, that Colossians wants us to see as the goal, is a maturity that is deep. The second element of maturity is maturity that has freedom to it. At the end of the text that we read, it says that God has transferred us from darkness into the kingdom of his beloved Son. We have been freed in Christ. Freedom is part of the maturity, and as we go through the book of Colossians, we're going to see other ways in which our minds can or have been enslaved and trapped. Maturity is freedom. And then third, maturity is order. Maturity has an order to it, and we can imagine that this is where adulting comes in. This is where we might think, you know, maturity is something I'm not quite sure I want. But that's not what Colossians is talking about. That's not the kind of order it's talking about. It's talking about order instead of chaos. The life of chaos is the immature life. That doesn't necessarily mean it's evil. The life of the seedling or the plant that's just beginning to sprout and bloom, there's an element of chaos. How is it going to develop? How are the branches going to form on it? It's not anywhere near mature yet. Yet it's still a good thing, but we want to see it grow and form and come to an order, to a maturity that has an order in it. So maturity also has an order characteristic to it. And then the fourth element that Colossians will draw out for us, will pull out for us, will teach us about, is the maturity of community. And here I'm talking about healthy community, good, stable, whole community. This isn't the community that suffocates you. That's a different kind of immature or false mature community. But we need maturity in order to be fully functioning human beings. We need community that actually empowers us. Maturity, with community as a characteristic, is a community that empowers us, and thereby we can be mature human beings, flourishing wonderfully to the fullness that we were intended to be. And then the fifth characteristic is the characteristic of fulfillment. And throughout the book of Colossians, the words thanksgiving come up again and again and again. This is kind of route one to maturity, says Colossians. You must be a person or people who give thanks. And when you start to give thanks, and as you continue to give thanks over your life, what you realize is that you are a fulfilled and a satisfied person. You are not someone who is grabbing and clutching after things, as you may have done when you were more immature. The maturity that Colossians speaks to is a maturity that has depth, a maturity that has freedom, maturity of order, community, and fulfillment. These are the five characteristics that we'll be exploring over the next few Sundays. Now, for myself, as I study maturity, as I've been thinking about maturity for the last little while here, I started to think back, you know, where was I about 10 years ago? What was happening in my life then? And just almost 10 years ago now, I was driving from the east to the west. I used to live in Regina and was heading out to Vancouver. And this was an interesting trip for me, but one thing that sticks out in my mind that I remember very much so is the vehicle that Sarah and I were driving. We were in a Volkswagen Rabbit, and our eldest daughter, she's now 9, almost 10, had just been born. She was 20 days old. She was 20 days old, and as we were driving, we packed this car so full that we couldn't see the child from the front. We left a lot of our large items in Regina in storage at somebody's house, but we took everything else that we needed for, we thought we would be there for 2 years. We'll bring everything we need and just stuff this car as full as it can go, and then we don't have to rent a U-Haul. And so we packed it all over Karis. Like, just, she's in a car seat, and so it's got a roll bar. Stuff's not going to fall on her. I've got bags propped there, so it's not going to hit her. It's fine. But Sarah and I had this continuing kind of vision or nightmare, if you will, that along the road, we're going to get stopped by a police officer, not because I speed, but we're going to get stopped by a police officer for some reason or other. He's just checking up, and he's going to look in the back seat and say, "What's going on back here? I think there's a person there." And sure enough, he'll get very angry at us and throw all our stuff on the street and tell us, "You can't do this." And then he'll hear the dog bark and he'll say, "You have a dog in there too." Yeah. And we came along the highway to Golden, and I hadn't booked a hotel yet. And it was already late, and I did what any self-respecting 27-year-old man would do. I called my mom. "Could you please find us a hotel that takes pets in Golden?" A few moments later, she calls back. "Your father and I have found a hotel." She tells me where it is. We drive in. Everything works out great, but I'm stuck with the image of the way I packed the car, the way Sarah and I hadn't planned for a hotel, the way I felt when I found out, oh, she told my dad, and just what that meant of how mature am I, you know? My dad's like the traveling guru. He never misses a connection. He's always on time, and I didn't have a hotel for my family. Over the last few years, if you came and visited me, if you saw me then and you see me now, what you'd like to know is, has this young man grown up? Has he matured? And we really should be alarmed if the young man had not matured at all. We certainly want him to still be playful, but we also want him to mature. But what I want to challenge us today is not just maturity in the sense of responsibility, but maturity, I want that young man to have matured in the maturity that Colossians speaks of, in depth. Does this man have a depth, a connection to Christ that goes deeper than skin level? Has he begun to have a knowledge and understanding of God? That kind of depth. Does this young man have freedom, or is he enslaved? Is he entrapped to addictions or things in his life that kind of hem him in and control him? Does this young man, has he moved towards a maturity of freedom? And then order as well. And then community. Does he expose himself to community and allow community to be a part of his life that enriches and enlivens his life to that fullness of maturity that Colossians speaks of? And then fulfillment. Is this a young man who has learned to give thanks? That's the kind of maturity that I would expect us to look for in those of us who are new to Christianity. If we see someone who's new to Christianity, and then a little while later, we come back 2 years later, and they look like the same person, we should be as alarmed as if it was a newborn child that hadn't grown in 2 years. We need to be looking for maturity in one another. We need to be trying to help each other, build each other up into maturity in Christ. This is the vision that Colossians gives us. This is what Paul is talking about when he says, everything I have, all the energy that God gives me, inspires me to, I will work towards the maturing of the communities that I work with. How do we get there? So, we have painted a picture of the good life, if you will, the good life of Colossians. This is different often than what maybe marketing might tell you the good life is. We've painted a picture of the good life, the mature Christian. How do we get there? Do I need to barter for it? Do I need to make a trade? Is there something I have to give up? Maybe it's my fun. I have to give up my fun to be a mature Christian. What do I have to give up? Maybe it's not bartering. Maybe I have to train. Maybe I need to train myself up to be a mature Christian. I'll pick one of those five and I'll work on it like I work on a treadmill, and eventually I'll get all five and then I'll be a mature Christian. I think the problem with both of those models is that we have made the mistake of thinking that we can get to maturity on our own, and that maturity means independence. But the maturity that Colossians speaks of is not a maturity of independence, but a maturity of dependence upon God and who He is. Because you see, a maturity without dependence on God gets twisted into a false maturity that leaves us hopeless, that leaves us actually empty. So a maturity that has no God in it, a maturity without God, the depth becomes something that drowns us. Look how big the world you live in is. Look how complex the relationships around you are. The depth of all of this is so much so that you will drown in it. It will overwhelm you, unless God is a part of it. The maturity that I'm speaking of has freedom in it, yet without God, you will put something else there in His place. Something else will be God for you, whether that's an idea or a construction of your mind, or it's a work, or it's money, or it's fame, or it's... You will put something there. You will not be free without God. And then a maturity that aims for order but does not have God in it will be a maturity that is false because it is based around legalism. And then a maturity that does not have God in it but tries to be mature around community will end up being a maturity that suffocates you. It will be a false mature community. It will be a community that teaches you that the community itself is God, and that there is no other God. And then a maturity without God that offers to you fulfillment will end up keeping you circled in upon yourself. You will have to be the source and the end of your own fulfillment. And we all know that this is lonely, that this is selfish, and that this can only end in despair and darkness. What we need is a maturity that's based upon God, where depth is connected to Him, freedom is connected to Him, order, community, and fulfillment are all found in Him and orchestrated by Him in our lives. This is the maturity we long for. Therefore, our relationship with God needs to be a right relationship. It needs to be a good relationship for us to grow into this maturity. Oh, but there's the problem, isn't it? Which one of us can have a good relationship with God day in and day out and not stumble? Which one of us can have that good relationship with God, can look back over the history of our lives and say, that's okay, I've got a good relationship with God, I have not failed? Each and every one of us. None of us can reach to that point and say that we can have a good relationship with God on our own. We cannot make our relationship with Him right. The bad news is you can't do it. You can't make your relationship with God right in order to be mature in Him. But the confusing news, of course, is that even though I've just told you that, you don't have to make your relationship with Him right. Because as the text tells us, Jesus Christ has already made that relationship between you and God, your Heavenly Father. He has made this a right, a true, and a good relationship. He has transferred us from darkness into the kingdom of His beloved Son. He has given us redemption through the forgiveness of our sins. This is where we find our relief. This is where we find our ultimate hope. Because in Him, we find that our relationship with God has been righted. It has been made true. It has been made holy and wonderful. And so then, from that foundation, we can place our ultimate hope in God and what He has already done for us. We can place our hope in something that is permanent, who Jesus is, what He has done, His resurrection, and what He says He will come to do for us. This is where our hope rests. It rests in something permanent and eternal. When your hope rests in something that is temporary, what ends up happening is your life will turn towards immaturity because the temporary hope cannot sustain more than that. But when your hope rests on something eternal and permanent, your life will turn towards maturity. And if you're feeling this morning, this all sounds very good, but you don't know me, and you don't know what's happening in my life, and you don't see the very tiny sliver of hope that makes me cling to even waking up in the morning and getting out of bed. My encouragement for you then would be to see how verse 5 directs us to where we find our hope. Hope is the fuel in this text for the love that these Colossians have for all the saints, and the hope comes from the word of truth. The word of truth will build us up in hope. This is the promise. And all of His promises, as we have already sang, are yes and amen. The word of truth will build us up in hope. So if you're struggling, if you're feeling thin on hope today, my encouragement for you is to find the places where you can receive the word of truth. Whether that's reading the Bible by yourself, whether that's participating in a house church where you speak about and read and talk about the text together, or maybe that's through singing the songs, as we have already sung this morning, as we have sung about what God is, who He is, and what He has done for us. And as we continue to do that, these are songs that are inspired by, worked on through Scripture. I'm going to invite the band to come on out here to lead us through the closing song. As we respond to Him, my prayer for you is that your hope would indeed grow and flourish, that you would live a life full of hope. Find relief in the sense, in the knowledge, that Jesus Christ has redeemed you. He has put your relationship with God all correct, all true, and all right. And then look forward to maturity. Look forward to the goal of maturity in Christ and put your hope in Him who has redeemed you. Amen.